Everybody out this morning. We've got a few announcements for you. We are having a new member class right after this service, right across over there in the chapel. So if you are thinking about it, want to learn more about the church, I invite you to join us for that right after this service. Family Promise, starting Easter Sunday, we need more volunteers, so there is a sign-up sheet right outside. Join Peter Salinas every Thursday, and they're about to wrap it up. It ends March 28th, this study on the book of Revelation. Women's Bible study, second and fourth Wednesday of every month. Their next one is March 27th. Holy Week, we have Palm Sunday, normal services that morning. Then Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, both 5:30 services, and then our normal service times on Easter Sunday.
Today, all over the world, we are gathering in large groups and small, in different places and different languages, in buildings and schools, empty spaces and open fields, in our homes and on our phones. Some come together in freedom, while others have to meet in secret. Some will sing the old hymns, while others are singing something new. We'll all learn different things from the same Bible and worship the same God in different ways. We are the church, the body of Christ, different pieces molded together by the hand of God. Today, all over the world, we are gathering as one.
So let's stand as one and praise our God.
Three, four.
This song.
Almighty God, our Redeemer, in our weakness, we have failed to be your messengers of forgiveness and hope. Renew us by your Holy Spirit, that we may follow your commands and proclaim your reign of love through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And please be seated for this next one.
One, two, three.
On us, O God, have mercy on us, O God, have mercy on us, O God, for we have sinned. Have mercy, tender God, forget that I divide you. Wash away.
Well, good morning and happy St. Patrick's Day. I see some green floating around out there. In the heart of our journey through the book of Daniel, today we arrive at a story that not only challenges our faith, but also invites us to reflect on the depth of our conviction and the strength of our allegiance to God. Today we're going to embark on a journey back to a time when the hottest real estate in town was a fiery furnace in Babylon. So exclusive that even VIPs like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego got an all-expense-paid trip courtesy of King Nebuchadnezzar. So the backdrop of the story is set in the ancient kingdom of Babylon under the rule of this evil king Nebuchadnezzar. So the king decides to put up this enormous golden statue of himself, which is basically a giant selfie to his ego. And he told everybody, this is just a big, shiny reminder of how divine I am. Then he commands a game of Simon Says, where Simon says, bow down to me, except Simon is a statue, and if you don't play along, it's not just out of the game, but into the furnace. So talk about extreme sports. And this puts all of the God-fearing people in a bit of a pickle, turning their daily walk of faith into kind of a choose-your-own-adventure game, except the churches, the choices are bow down or become barbecue. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stand out in this story as examples of steadfast faith and courage. Their refusal to bow down to the king's statue, despite the threat of being cooked alive, speaks volumes about their trust in God. They're not swayed by the prospect of death, but remain committed to their belief that God is the only one worthy of worship. So this episode in Daniel highlights several key themes that are as relevant today as they were in ancient times. And it teaches us that faith obeys God instead of following people. Faith believes in spite of what it sees. And faithful obedience is our responsibility. The outcome is God's. The response of these three young men to the king's decree is a powerful testimony to their faith, and their miraculous survival from the fiery furnace is a testament to God's saving power. So we're going to explore this passage together, and while we do, let's consider our own faith and the situations in which we are called to stand firm. The story of these three young men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, encourages us to reflect on our own commitment to God, reminding us that our faith can withstand the fiercest of fires, and that God is always with us, even in the middle of the flames. Now, 1 Peter 1:7 offers a profound insight into the nature of faith and its value in the Christian life. This verse reads, these trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold, though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. At the heart of this verse is the comparison between faith and gold. It's a metaphor that beautifully illustrates the refining and purifying processes that both undergo. Just as gold is tested and refined by fire to prove its purity and worth, so too is the faith of believers tested through trials and tragedies and challenges. And these challenges serve a divine purpose to purify and strengthen our faith, proving its genuineness and worth. Peter emphasized that faith is of greater value than gold. See, gold is a precious metal that eventually perishes, while faith has an eternal significance. It endures beyond our temporal realm, carrying with it the promise of eternal life and salvation. The trials and difficulties that Christians face are not pointless hardships, but opportunities for growth, leading to a genuine, more genuine, and deeper faith. So let's begin with verses 5 and 6. When you hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipes, and other musical instruments, bow to the ground to worship King Nebuchadnezzar's golden statue. Anyone who refuses to obey will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace. See, today we stand together, not in the shadow of a golden statue, but in the light of God's truth, to explore a faith that has been tested through the ages, a faith that has been proven time and time again that it can be trusted. This royal decree from King Nebuchadnezzar, it was clear. When the symphony of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harps, pipes, and a myriad of other instruments fill the air, every knee was to bow down to this golden statue. And the penalty for defiance? A searing death in the king's blazing furnace. Yet amidst this decree, we'll witness the emergence of three qualities of standing in faith that are as instructive as they are instrumental, inspirational. The first is, faith obeys God instead of following man. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stood resolute, an embodiment of holy defiance and unwavering faith. I mean, when summoned before Nebuchadnezzar, their response was unflinching and filled with conviction. We do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. These three men, they were undaunted in their trust and devotion to Almighty God, and they understood that true faith does not waver before the edicts of man, for it is grounded in the unshakable sovereignty, power, and authority of the one who reigns supreme over all creation. In that moment, they stood as a shining example and testament to the strength and depth of their faith, refusing to bow down to any gods or powers, knowing that their ultimate allegiance rested solely with their Heavenly Father. Their unyielding faith in God's power and unwavering trust in His divine protection propel them to take a bold stance, firmly rooted in the assurance that no matter the outcome, their God was able to deliver them from any and all challenges that might lay before them. They steadfastly held on to a belief that He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the one who holds their lives in His all-knowing, all-loving hands. As word of their faith spread, others began to take note of their resolve. They marveled at the unyielding courage and resolute determination exhibited by Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Theirs was a faith that transcended all earthly circumstances, a faith that illumined the darkness, a faith that continues to inspire and uplift believers millennia later. And so, as they were thrown into the blazing furnace, their faith remained unshaken. The flames may have consumed the ropes that bound them, but their spirits remained steadfast in their trust of the God who holds all power and authority. And suddenly, Nebuchadnezzar, who had once sought to dominate them, witnessed a miraculous sight. He saw not three men engulfed in flames, but four walking unharmed amidst the inferno. It was an awe-inspiring testament to the faithfulness and supernatural protection of their Heavenly Father. And when they emerged from that fiery furnace and their bodies were unharmed, Nebuchadnezzar was humbled and filled with awe. He recognized the power and the authority of God, declaring, "Praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent His angels and rescued His servants." In that moment, the invincibility of their faith was validated, and their unbroken trust in God had triumphed over the schemes of the enemy. In a world filled with uncertainties and shifting sands, their story serves as a beacon of hope, reminding us that faith is not a fleeting emotion, but a steadfast commitment to the unchanging character of God. Just as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego experienced divine deliverance, we too can anchor our trust in the Almighty and confidently face the fires of life, knowing that He is with us every step of the way. And my hope is that their unwavering faith will continue to ignite a flame within our hearts, propelling us to stand firm and unwavering in our devotion to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Now, secondly, faith believes in spite of what it sees. Their faith was not blind. It was incredibly visionary and profoundly unwavering. With unshakable devotion, they fearlessly proclaimed, "The Almighty God whom we humbly serve is not only abundantly capable of saving us, but eagerly yearns to do so." In the face of the very real dangers that surrounded them, their faith soared above earthly limitations, penetrating the realm of the imperceptible to behold the steadfast power of a compassionate and merciful God who possessed the extraordinary ability to snatch them victoriously from the fiery furnace. In the depths of their unwavering devotion and profound belief, they found solace, strength, and unyielding hope. Their faith, steadfast and fortified, flourished in the face of adversity, blooming with resilience and resolve as they stood in defiance against the flames that threatened to consume them. Their absolute, unwavering trust in Almighty God shimmered like a beacon of light that couldn't be dimmed. With each breath, their faith cradled them in the arms of resilience, whispering words of reassurance and igniting a keen sense of purpose. They didn't merely possess faith. Instead, they embodied it, becoming living testaments to the power that that faith held. Their spirits, intertwined with an unbreakable bond, embraced the extraordinary, finding strength in the invisible and fortitude in the intangible. The fiery furnace that loomed before them held no sway over their conviction. While others trembled and cowered, they stood tall, resolute in their trust in a compassionate and merciful God. Their firm trust in the Almighty became an anthem of hope, a song of triumph that reverberated down through the very core of their beings. In the face of the unforgiving fire, they found a peace enveloped in the arms of God who delighted in their devotion. With each passing moment, their faith grew stronger, their connection with the divine deepened, and their resolve intensified. And the compassionate and merciful God they served, armed with boundless love and infinite power, descended upon the fiery furnace, shattering its oppressive grip. And with a touch that defied reason and transcended understanding, He pulled them from the clutches of destruction and guided them towards safety. Their victory was not just a triumph over the tangible flames, but a testament to the immeasurable strength of their faith. And as their story echoed through the ages, it served as a reminder of the transformative power that faith possesses. It beckons humanity to embrace the unwavering conviction that lies deep within us, to trust in the invisible, to seek solace in the embrace of a compassionate and merciful God. The tale of their fearless defiance serves as a beacon of hope, illuminating the path of those who dare to believe in the extraordinary and witness the power of faith. And lastly, faithful obedience is our responsibility. But the outcome is God's. See, these brave and steadfast men understood that their primary responsibility was not to speculate on the results, but rather to wholeheartedly devote themselves to obedience. They fearlessly declared, "Even if God chooses not to intervene, we will never succumb to the temptation of bowing down to your false gods or idolizing the golden statue that you have corrected. We believe that God can. We believe that God will. But even if he doesn't, we will still remain devoted to him." They acknowledged that the realm of determining the outcome belongs solely to God, while our steadfastness lies in remaining loyal and unwavering in our faith. It's through this unwavering faithfulness that we find our true purpose. And what was the outcome? King Nebuchadnezzar himself, astonished by the divine mystery that unfolded before him, beheld not merely three, but the miraculous and inexplicable presence of four people within the scorching furnace. And as he gazed upon this extraordinary sight, it became uncertainly clear that the fourth figure was none other than the Son of God, radiating an unworldly brilliance that surpassed all earthly understanding and comprehension. This awe-inspiring and mesmerizing demonstration of divine intervention and protection left no room for doubt, skepticism, or disbelief, for not even the slightest harm had fallen on these people who fearlessly walked through these intimidating flames, emerging unscathed and untouched. Their bodies untouched, unharmed. Not a single hair upon their heads was even singed. Their garments untainted, unruffled by the searing, scorching inferno. Remarkably, there was not even a trace or a scent of fire on them, as the flames themselves had recognized their unwavering faith and chosen to honor their devotion and courage. And in awe, Nebuchadnezzar exclaimed in great astonishment and reverence, "Praise be to the mighty and glorious God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego." He fully acknowledged and appreciated the unwavering faith and loyalty that they exhibited as they fearlessly and resolutely placed their complete trust and confidence in God, courageously disregarding the king's decree, even when faced with the dire consequence of sacrificing their own precious lives, rather than yielding to the demands of bowing down to and worshiping any other deity besides their own Almighty God. So let's take heart from this cherished message of inspiration and encouragement. Our unwavering faith, when put to the test, emerges as a powerful testament to the strength and resilience of our spirits. And just as the three Hebrew men fearlessly stood firm in their conviction, let us also stand unwavering in our devotion, knowing deep within our souls that our faithfulness resounds throughout the heavenly realms and resonates for all eternity. In this journey of faith, let us trust, always trust, and remain anchored in our faith in Almighty God. For it is through His infinite grace and divine guidance that we navigate through the tribulations of life. Just this week, I saw a meme online that said, "My God is stronger than leukemia." Hey, it spoke to me, so I shared it as a testimony. And I received a private message from a person who said, but apparently not stronger than pancreatic cancer. Shaky theology. This person who I know, have known for years, had a child that was lost to cancer years ago, and she also lost her faith at the same time. And I can't judge her at all. I can't imagine losing a child. But I did respond by saying I stood by my statement. God is what has sustained me over the last 20 years. Even if I am never healed of leukemia, even if it kills me, my faith in God remains. As the guys in our story said, I believe He can, I believe He will, but even if He doesn't, I will still believe. May our lives serve as a resounding echo, a resplendent embodiment of the courage exemplified by those who courageously traverse through the scorching flames of adversity and emerged unscathed, their spirits ablaze in the radiant presence of God Himself. May we continue to find solace in the unwavering faith and steadfastness of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and may their story inspire us to greater heights of devotion. Let our hearts be filled with unwavering faith, our minds steadfast in our beliefs, and our spirits ablaze with the divine spark of courage. For it's in our unwavering devotion to God that we find strength, comfort, and protection. Let's also remember that just as the fourth figure in the fire appeared in the fire, so too does God's presence manifest in our lives, guiding us through the trials and tribulations that lie ahead. So let's keep our faith set to trust in God, because He's got every outcome in His hands. And remember, when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze, unless you're a marshmallow, then I can't make any promises. But as we walk this path of unwavering faith, let us do so with the conviction and confidence of knowing that our God is with us always and forever. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, we come before You with hearts full of awe and gratitude. Your power, grace, and mercy shine brighter than the flames that once rose in Babylon's furnace. Lord, You are our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. And today we stand in reverence of Your might and steadfast love. Father, as we reflect on the unwavering faith of these three devout servants, we ask for the courage to face the furnaces of our own lives. May the fires that we encounter refine us and not consume us. Grant us the strength to stand firm in our convictions, to obey You rather than people, and to remain steadfast, knowing that You are with us, even when the heat of life's challenges surrounds us. Lord, fill us with a faith that believes even when our eyes can't see the way out. Help us to trust in Your saving power and Your will, which is perfect and pleasing. When the music of this world plays and beckons us to bow to the idols of our time, help us to remain upright, focused on Your eternal promises. And we acknowledge, O God, that our responsibility is to obey, and the outcome is in Your hands. Whether You deliver us from hardship or walk with us through it, may our hearts always sing Your praise. Teach us to trust not in the deliverance we desire, but in Your divine presence that is always with us. As we leave this place, may the story of Your servants who emerged from the fire without even the smell of smoke remind us that nothing is impossible for You. Let this assurance settle in our spirits that no matter what furnace we face, Your presence is a shield around us. And Father, we pray for Your holy Catholic Church, that we all may be one. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve You that your name may be glorified by all people. We pray for all pastors, that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world, that there may be justice and peace on the earth. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake, that our works may find favor in your sight. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble, that they may be delivered from their distress. And we praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom. And let us pray for our own needs and those of others, using the words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. When trouble is in my way, can't tell my night from day, I'm tossed from side to side, like a ship on a raging tide. I don't worry and I don't fret, God has never failed me yet. Trouble coming from time to time, that's alright, I'm not the worrying kind, because I've got confidence, God is gonna see me through. No matter what the case may be, I know he's gonna fix it for me. I've got confidence, God is gonna see me through. No matter what the case may be, I know he's gonna fix it for me. Job was scared oh so long, till the flesh fell from his bones. His wife, his cattle, his children, everything that he had was gone. But Job, he didn't despair, he knew that God still cared. Sleepless days and sleepless nights, Job said, honey, that's all right, because I've got confidence, God is gonna see me through. No matter what the case may be, I know he's gonna fix it for me. I've got confidence, God is gonna see me through. No matter what the case may be, I know he's gonna fix it for me. Some folks wonder how I smile, even though I'm going through trials. How can I have a song? Everything is going wrong. I don't worry and I don't fret, God has never failed me yet. Trouble coming from time to time, that's alright, I'm not the worrying kind, because I've got confidence, God is gonna see me through. No matter what the case may be, I know he's gonna fix it for me. I've got confidence, God is gonna see me through. No matter what the case may be, I know he's gonna fix it for me. I've got confidence, God is gonna see me through. No matter what the case may be, I know he's gonna fix it for me. I've got confidence, God is gonna see me through. No matter what the case may be, I know he's gonna fix it for me.
And as this fades down, I'm gonna invite Ida to come forward.
No matter what the case may be.
Thank you. I hate it when they fade a track out. What do you do? I can't fade my voice. Anyway, we are called into the Church of Jesus Christ by baptism and marked as Christ's own by the Holy Spirit. It's our common calling to be disciples and servants of our servant Lord. Within the community of the church, some are called to particular service as deacons, elders, and as ministers of word and sacrament. Ordination is Christ's gift to the church, assuring that his ministry continues among us, providing for ministries of caring and compassion in the world, ordering the governance of the church, and preaching and administering the word and sacraments. So representing the Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, we now ordain Ida to the office of elder and install her to active service on the session. Ordination calls the whole church to renewed commitment and reminds us to bear gladly the yoke of Christ given in the covenant of baptism. Therefore, let us all reaffirm our baptismal vows, renouncing all that opposes God and God's rule, and affirming the faith of the Holy Catholic Church. So these questions are for everybody. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? Do you? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept Him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in His grace and love? Do you? Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying His word and showing His love? Will you? Let's all profess our faith by saying together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. These are the constitutional questions for you. Do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledging Him Lord of all, head of the church, and through Him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Do you? Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testament to be by the Holy Spirit the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ and the church universal and God's word to you? Do you? Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? Do you and will you?
I do and I will.
Will you fulfill your office in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you? Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Will you?
I will.
Will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Will you?
I will.
Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Do you? Will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? Will you? Will you be a faithful elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in governing bodies of the church, and in your ministry? Will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you? Do you, the members of the church, accept Ida as an elder, chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? Do you? Do we agree to encourage her, to respect her decisions, and to follow as she guides us, serving Jesus Christ who alone is head of the church? Do we?
We do.
If you are an elder, you don't have to currently be serving on the session, but if you would like to come down and be a part of this, we invite you now. As Bob Barker would say, come on down. And let's pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for your steadfast faithfulness to us. In every age, you've called forth leaders to serve you and equip them with your gifts. Among your people, Israel, you anointed prophets, priests, and rulers. You called pastors and teachers, bishops, elders, and deacons to build up your church. With Moses, the 70 elders bore the burdens of your people, ministering in the power of your Spirit. Alongside the apostles, deacons cared for all in need and guarded the community's peace. In the church, deacons, elders, and pastors served together so that your whole people might be equipped for ministry and built up in the full unity of Christ. for your servants in every age, O God. And for the Church of Jesus Christ, we give you all thanks and praise. God of grace, pour out your Holy Spirit on Ida, that she may be your faithful elder in the church. Give her prudence and sound judgment, wisdom and courage to order the life of the church in obedience to your word. Nourish her in the life of the Holy Spirit, that she may exercise the ministry of discipline with humility and compassion. Guide her in governance on this session and in every court of the church, that she may be a servant leader, following Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life to set others free. Give her joy in her walk of faith and a sure sense of your abiding presence for her work of ministry. Gracious God, through the waters of baptism, you have claimed us as your own and called us to share in Christ's ministry. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that we may discern the gifts you have given, calling them forth from one another, and together use these gifts for the good of all. In obedience to Christ and in the unity of his Spirit, may we proclaim good news, make disciples, be light and leaven, share our bread, offer a cup of cold water, wash one another's feet. Make us strong in Christ to live as your people and show forth your saving love in the world by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Ida, you are now an elder in the Church of Jesus Christ and for this congregation. Be faithful and true in your ministry so that your whole life will bear witness to the crucified and risen Christ. And welcome to the session. Meeting Tuesday night. That's right. This time we'd like to give you an opportunity to support the ministries of our church. We're going to pass the plates around. We've got some donation boxes in the back. And we also have this QR code if you prefer to give online by some kind of credit or debit card.
Hello. There we are. This is a new song that we've been learning, and we're going to start teaching it to you. Come to the table as far as like learning about the Lord. 3, 4.
To the table.
Gracious God, you sent Jesus to change our lives in bold and amazing ways. Yet we are often consumed by the pettiness of our own to-do lists. As we place this offering before you, help us to surrender completely to your love and to be stirred into fruit-bearing action that results in faithful stewardship. For it's in your holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please stand as we go out with an Irish blessing. Sally down here who would be honored and would love to pray with you and for you. But now go, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that Christ commanded. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forever. Amen.
May the Lord